everybody. Welcome back. Jiu-Jitsu 2000 here. I'm coming back at you with another 45 Long Colt reloading video today. If you're a subscriber to my channel, or if you're just someone who pops in and out on occasion and views my material, you might be aware of the fact that I already have two 45 Long Colt reloading videos on my channel. And you might be sitting there wondering to yourself, why is he doing a third video on that same caliber? Well, let me try to briefly explain what the differences is between those two videos and the one I'm filming right now. Okay, in a nutshell, those two videos, I have a long version and a short version, and they're basically versions of the same thing. The reason I'm saying versions of the same thing is, and what I'm referencing that to, is the type of bullet, the type of projectile that I used in both of those previous videos. And the type of bullet that I used was a factory bullet. It was a copper-plated lead bullet. It was a Hornady jacketed lead bullet. So if you're going to be looking for a 45 Long Colt video using a jacketed bullet, factory bullet, I'm going to post links here to those two videos. Now let's talk about what I'm filming right now. The video that I'm filming right now, my objective is to reach out to all you bullet casters out there, okay? All you people out there, even if you're not a bullet caster, maybe you're a person who likes to buy cast bullets from someone or someplace. That's the focus of today's video, okay? So, copper jacketed bullets, cast lead bullets. That's the difference. I hope you like the information. Right now, we're looking at my bench, and I'm showing you some of the things that you might need to reload this cartridge. Now, the very first thing that you have to have, obviously, is brass. And in this case, I'm using brand new brass that's never been fired. So that's the first component that you'll need. The next thing that you'll need is some primers. I'm going to be using Winchester large pistol primers. This is the bullets that I'm going to be using. It's a Lee cast 230 grain bullet. It's a great bullet. You're going to need some dies. And as part of the dies, you're also going to need not just them, but you're going to need a shell holder. And this is the type that has the little groove on the bottom that fits into the press. Some of the other things that you might need are trimming tools, such as these Lee trimmers. This is the case length gauge. This is the shell holder. And this is the chuck. And basically what you do is you put that chuck into your drill, and then you use the cutter here with the case length gauge, and you chuck the cases up into your drill and you trim them. And I'll show you what that process looks like. This is a deburring tool. You'll need one of these, and this is going to be used after you trim your brass. This is a brush. I like to have that handy to go inside the case mouths to clean the case mouths, generally after I deburr them. You're going to need a powder scale. You could use a digital scale, or you can use a balance scale. Sometimes I use both because I like to compare my weights of my charges between the two scales. You're going to need a powder funnel to put the powder into the cases. You might need a trickler if you have one. This is not a necessity, but it does help make the process a little nicer. And also I have some little scoops. This scoop is a scoop that I made that throws just about the right amount if I'm using unique. And this is a little scoop that I like to use to dip my powder. Now I'll explain all this as I get into the process. These are some digital calipers. Now they don't have to be digital. They can be analog. But the reason you'll need calipers is to measure things. Diameters of bullets, lengths of cases, things like that. Now, a minute ago, I talked about trimming.
And I forgot to mention that there's another option for trimming, and that's a lathe style trimmer. I'll talk about that a little later. And I also was talking about the lock stud that goes into a drill. So in the back over here, you see I have a Makita drill ready to go. You're also going to need some case lubricant. And what this does, and this case lubricant is sprayed onto the cases, and it makes them so that they can go into the dies nice and easily. Now the one that I prefer is actually this Dillon DCL, Dillon Case Lube. It's great stuff. I really like it because it has two components in it. It has lanolin and isopropyl alcohol. And it works really good because the alcohol is used as a propellant to carry the lanolin through the air, and then it sticks to the cases, and then what happens is the alcohol evaporates off, and then what's left behind is the lanolin, and that's what is used to lubricate your cases. Another option is the Hornady One Shot, and this stuff's really good. It comes in this little aerosol can, works really good. It's very excellent case lube. Another thing that you can do is you can get RCBS. I used to have one. It's a little lube pad, and what it is it's you basically lay your cases out on this little lube pad, and you run your fingers across them, and you put this little oil on the pad, and that's another way to lube your cases, and that works pretty well as also. Now you might be thinking about the type of dies that I'm using. Now you sit there and you see where it says carbide sit. You're like, carbide, huh? Well, what that refers to is carbide ring on the decapping and resizing die, and more specifically the fact that you don't have to lube your cases because of the carbide ring. But me, I like to lube them anyway. To me, it doesn't hurt anything, so I go ahead and lube everything. You're also going to need some powder, and in our case we're going to be using Alliant Unique. It's an excellent powder. Now let me back to case lube again. One thing that you can use in a pinch, and I've done this on some occasions when I ran out of either One Shot or I didn't have any DCL and I ran into a pinch, you can use a can of Pledge. So I always keep a can of Pledge on my bench. This works good in a last ditch effort to lube your cases. Plus they smell good and it kind of cleans them up. So yeah, you can use Pledge. Over here, I have a bullet puller. This is in case I make a mistake on something and I need to pull the bullet out of the case. I have a flashlight, a crescent wrench, and a pair of channel locks. Now, you're probably wondering how I'm going to prime my cases. Now, generally, you could use a hand primer like this Lee Auto Prime tool. You basically insert the case in there and you push this little button, it puts a primer into the bottom of the case. That's a good option. But in our case, we're going to be using the priming arm that's on our press right here. This flips out and it fits down in there. And then you basically put your primer in there. I'll show you the process when we get to it. But that's the process that we're going to use in this video. And last but not least, and certainly most importantly, is load data. You got to have plenty of load data, and there's several ways and places where you can find load data. I like to write all my stuff down on a card, piece of paper, what my recipe is, what my powder is, what my primer is, trim length, overall length, all those things. I like to do that. And when you sit there and you look at my overall length, it says 1.575 inches. And that's for this particular bullet. But in the book it says your overall length cannot go past 1.60. So overall length, as far as I'm concerned, because I'm shooting these out of a revolver, the overall length is not that significant on this gun, for the gun that I'm using. But as long as I don't exceed 1.60. So whatever overall length I find that's within this spec is going to be fine for me. Now, when we go talk about the bullets that I'm going to be using, they're sized to 0.452.
I run these through a Lee sizing die, and they're sized to .452. Now, if these bullets were going to be loaded in a 45 ACP, they would need to be sized to .451. Now, that brown color that you see on the bullet, that's the Lee Liquid Alox bullet lubricant. That's this stuff. And it works excellent. So basically, after you cast your bullets, you put them into a butter dish, if you will, and you shake that Liquid Alox on them. And it, what that coating does is it helps eliminate leading in your barrel. It lubricates the bullet. Now, so again, I'm loading 45 Colt Winchester large pistol primers. My trim length of my brass is going to be 1.275. My overall length, I already talked about that. My bullet, I already talked about that. Now, unique. That's the powder I'm going to be using. Anywhere from 7.4 grains up to 9.3 grains. But in our case today, we're going to be running about 8.4, 8.5. But as long as we're within this spectrum, somewhere within 7.4 or 9.3, we could be like 9.0, we could be 7.8. As long as we're within this spectrum, we're pretty good. Now, sometimes when I'm loading for accuracy, I will measure and weigh every single charge and they will be spot on. But today, I'm going to be throwing the powder by volume, and I'll do a few by hand, but I'm not going to be real particular on consistency because these are just going to be shot out of an old 45 Colt revolver. I'm not looking for high accuracy or anything. And then at the bottom, I always write down if the cases have been trimmed or not. Now, some of the sources where you can get load data would be books. Now, you know, these books are great because they give you a lot of information. They give you trim lengths, they give you what kind of powders you can use, start loads, max loads, velocities. They give you a ton of great information in these books. So you need some load data books. This is the Lyman Cast Handbook. This is a great book, fourth edition. And this really has some great information when it comes to casters. One thing that I want to note and make sure you understand is when you get to the particular bullet that you're looking at, like in our case, 45 Colt, now you can see my trim length and my overall length, 1.60 and all those things, and then you look right here and it gives me what I size my bullet to, 0.452. But you want to make sure that you look at the side of the page. Make sure you're talking about handguns, because sometimes you'll find some old data that might be for a long gun. So our bullet's going to be finding data out of some of these books. Okay, another good book is this Lyman 49th edition. This is a great book as well. Has tons of good information in it. Same kind of thing, but you know, it's got good stuff. Let me see what they have in here for 45 Colt. 45 ACP and 45 GAP. Let's see, let's go back. 45 Colt. So let's see what it tells me. Yeah, it also tells you. And again, you look on the side and you see where it says handgun. You don't want it to say rifle. And it also tells you their size to .452. So it's a good source of information. And it also says 1.60 overall length. So we're kind of just looking around in here trying to find some load data. You know, but that's some sources of information is books. Now, another thing you could do is whatever powder you're using, generally speaking, they have a website. I'm looking on this can to try to see if they have it on here. It would be right here, alliantpowder.com. And what you can do is you can go on their website and you could type in what kind of powder you want to use. You know, like here's 44 mag information. This is, you know, based on their website. And you can print up load data from their website. like, here's some 45 Colt stuff, you know, and it's saying unique all the way from, you know, let's see, what do they got, a lead semi-wad cutter bullet. But anyway, if your bullet fits those specs, you know, you can find load data there. Another thing you could do is go to the Hodgdon website or the IMR website. Both of those websites have excellent load data, free of charge, and all you do is you just go in there and type in what kind of powder you want, and bam, they got tons of load data. It's great, it's free, you don't have to sign up anything or nothing like that. You just go in there and you get the load data. Now, while I was at the Alliant Powder Company's website, I saw a link that would let me request a reloader's guide. So I sent in for that, and this is what they sent me. It's kind of neat. It's a little book, and it has some load data. It shows, like, their complete line of powders, you know, shows all the powders they have. And then it also breaks down some load data for you. So most of it's shotgun stuff, but it did have some good stuff in here. I think there's some 45 Colt info in here as well. Let's see, these are all jacketed bullets, I think. But anyway, this gives you some information on what you can find. So that's, and it also gives you overall lengths, 1.55, 1.6, all that. So this is another great idea, you know, a place to find your load data is from books, internet. Go to their website, go to the IMR or Hodgdon website, and look at their reloading center, data center, I think they call it. So again, be careful and always research your data.
Okay, before we get started, I'd like to take a brief moment of your time and talk about safety. First thing, safety glasses. Make sure they're clear of obstructions. Put them on and wear them throughout the whole reloading process. We're going to be dealing with primers, powder. We're going to be dealing with a lot of things that could be flying, you know, trimming cases and brass and stuff flying through there. Take care of your eyes, people. You only have one set. Okay, that's the first part of safety. The second part of safety is researching your own data, doing your own research, okay? Yes, there's videos out on YouTube where people like me or other reloaders are giving great information. But at the end of the day, when you load that information into your gun and you pull the hammer back and you go click, whatever happens, that's on you. Okay, I shouldn't speak for everybody. I'm speaking for me. I'm not a reloading expert, okay? The information that I give you is based on my experiences and my research and my load data, my trim lengths, my bullet weights, my powder charges. At the end of the day, you have to do your own research because you're ultimately responsible for what happens when you pull that trigger.
The first thing that I like to do with my brass is I like to take my brass out and I lay it on a little towel. And then whichever method of lubricant that I choose to use, I'm going to go ahead and lube these cases now. In my case today, I'm going to just use this Dillon case lube. You know, a lot of people say don't use too much, and that's true, especially if you're using, you know, if you're loading for a rifle, because you don't, if you get too much lubrication around the neck and shoulder area of a rifle case, you could have some problems. And you know, what happens is the lubrication gets between the die and it creates hydraulic pressure, and that pressure creates ripples in the brass as the brass goes up into the resizing die. Now again, I want to make sure that you understand that we're using carbide dies and this step is not necessary. So I'm going to just let them sit there and I'll come back in about 10 minutes or so and all the alcohol will be gone and they'll be nice and lubed with lanolin. Okay, what I'd like to do now is take my first die in my set. So when you open the dies up, you'll see that there's two or three dies in the set, and in my case I have three dies. The first die is the decapping and resizing die, and this is noted by the decapping pin coming out of the bottom of the die. Now what you want to do before you even put this into the press is you want to make sure that this decapping pin is not too long. Okay, you only want it sticking out about 3/16 of an inch. If the die looks good, you can go ahead and start to insert it into the press. Now, I'm just going to give it a couple threads. I'm not going to go all the way in yet, because what I need to do is I need to install my shell holder. Okay, now this is what the shell holder looks like. Now, on the press, on most of your single stage presses, they have a standard groove in the ram, and you can see that that groove is a groove in which this notch goes into. Okay, so it's a corresponding groove for that notch. So you basically take the shell holder, you find that little groove, and you push it into place. That's how you install your shell holder. Now my shell holder is installed into my press. From here, I can go ahead and start to adjust my die. Now, what I want to do with my first die, my decapping die, is I want to raise the ram all the way up. And from here, I want to thread the die body down until the die body touches the shell holder. There it is, it's touching. If I was using just steel dies, I wouldn't do anything further. All I would do would be lock the die lock ring. But since we're using carbide dies, and we want to protect the carbide insert on the bottom of the die, when you get the die body touching the shell holder, you want to back the die back about a half of a turn or so. And from here, hold the die body so it doesn't spin, and tighten the die lock ring. And that separation that we created, again, not to reiterate, but that separation that we created is so that the carbide insert doesn't come in hard contact with the shell holder. Now, back when I was young into reloading, what we would do is we would raise the ram and we'd have a small washer, like a little fender washer or something on top of the shell holder. You could also do that. You know, it doesn't have to be anything exact. So now our decapping die is set up and it's ready for operation. At this point, I'm going to take the previously lubed brass, or it might not be lubed, but I'm going to insert it into the shell holder, and I'm going to raise the ram and push the brass upward all the way through the die. And what this does is this resizes the die, and if the case still had a primer in it, it would have popped the old primer out. So I'm going to do this, I'm going to repeat this process with all of my brass. Just in case you were wondering what would happen if there was primers, this little cup is a little primer catch cup, and it sits right here. And as you would raise the ram, this little hole, let me get my pointer here, you see this little hole right here? This is the hole in which the old primers would fall out and fall into this cup. But I'm not going to put this cup on because we don't have any primers anyway.
this is brand new brass. So I'm just raising it up, resizing the cases. Nothing too significant. It's a pretty simple process. You want to learn to get a sensitivity to your press so that you don't get things bound up. If you feel anything binding or sticking or anything like that, stop and look at what you're doing and see if you can find the problem. Here's just another view of the operation. I'm sorry if my hands are getting in the way. And if you're wondering what kind of press I'm using the RCBS Partner Press. Another thing that I forgot to mention earlier is if you start to notice that your press might be getting a little bit stiff, if you will, you can raise the RAM and take some household 3-in-1 oil. Just put a couple drops on the RAM. This will help lubricate the RAM and it'll make the process much smoother, much quieter, and you'll get more life out of your press because you won't have that RAM working real hard. I'm going to look up into the die, give you a nice little shot of what the brass looks like when it goes up in there. So I'm putting the brass in. That's what they look like going up into the die. So again, this is the decapping and resizing operation. Okay, all these cases have been decapped and resized, and basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to put them in a towel and I'm just going to get rid of any excess lubricant that might have been on them. Nothing too crazy. Just trying to clean them up a little bit. Just getting rid of that excess lube. Okay, I have a bunch of brass sitting there. And what I want to do is, I hope you can see this. I want to trim the brass to 1.275 inches. Now, since these bullets are going to be fired out of a revolver, the trim length is not crucial. Okay, so we can give or take a little bit. And that's, you know, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the Lee trimmer and lock stud. You know, this is the shell holder and the trim case length gauge, and this is the cutter and this is the lock stud. Now the cutters, I had a little thing sitting around here earlier, I don't know where I went with it, but the cutters come in a little package like this from Lee, and what's included in the package is the actual case length gauge and the shell holder. So both of these come in this package, and you can pick these up. They're not that expensive. So this is the start of the trim process. So to get started, I'm going to take my cordless drill with the lock stud, and I'm going to chuck the lock stud into my drill. I'm almost there, just like so. I'm going to lock that bad boy in. Now that sound that you're hearing, don't worry too much about that. That's the clutch on the drill. So now I take the shell holder and start to thread it onto the lock stud very mildly. Take the case that I want to trim, put it into the shell holder, and close the drill shut. Now let's set that aside for a minute and let's work on these pieces. This is the cutter and this is the case length gauge. I'm going to thread
the case length gauge into the cutter. You want to make sure that the cutter blades touch against the case length gauge. So the cutters are touching the case length gauge. From here, I'm basically going to spin the drill and insert this cutter in until this little tip here touches the shell holder. And what that'll do, let me go a little more, that'll trim the excess off of this brass. So you basically go until it bottoms out. Now, you notice that the outer area of this case is now very shiny. And the reason it's shiny is because I just trimmed it. So now I need to chamfer, I need to take rid of these burrs. You can feel these little burrs right here. I don't know if you can see them in the camera, but I need to take those burrs off. So I'm going to use the outside edge and deburr this case. Now you don't want to use a lot of, I guess what I'm trying to say is you don't want to remove a lot of brass. Now let's do the next one. Same thing. We're going to lock this in. Get the cutter. Trim. Chamfer. The secret is don't remove a lot of brass. I've seen so many people trim their cases and then when they go for their deburring tool, they take a ton of brass off. That's not what you want. You're not cutting brass down, you're just deburring. All you're doing is taking off the rough edges. You can feel them. See how shiny that is? Now let's check them for length and see what they look like. Now we're supposed to be approximately around 1.275. Right there, 1.275. Let's take a look and see what we have. Let's turn these on. Open them up. And again, like I said earlier, wow, that's right on the money. Those are pretty accurate. Let me check another one. These two back here are the ones I did. Let's check. 1.274. So we're good. These are going in a revolver, so these rounds are going to be sitting in a cylinder. They look really good. So there's, you know, if we were loading for like a 45 ACP or some kind of pistol that has a semi-automatic or something like that, these trim lengths would be much, much more important. But like I said, they're going in a revolver. Not that big of a deal. Technically, my opinion, if you wanted to, you could totally skip this step. But it's up to you. I like to trim them. Another method of trimming cases that works very well is a lathe style trimmer such as this Lyman Universal. I actually prefer this if I'm doing large amounts of brass. And what it has is it has a universal shell holder, which you basically put the shell in there, and it has a pilot. And there's several different sizes of pilots that you can get depending on what size the mouth of the case is. So basically you put the pilot into the case mouth and then you lock the case into position. Then from here you turn this cutter using the handle, using the handle over here, you turn this cutter and it'll cut the excess brass off of the case. From here, you can take it out and you can chamfer and deburr. Now there's a lot of different case trimmers that you can get on the market. This one happens to be the Lyman Universal. I really like it. You can get a power attachment over here that'll attach to the trimmer. And what it'll do is it'll make it where you can hook it up to a drill. And they do a good job. They do a really good job. So let me zoom in a little bit and give you a little bit better view of what's going on. So just like so, put the case in. Close that bad boy. So I'm going to just lightly chamfer and deburr. It doesn't take a lot. Let's do a couple more. You see the little bits of brass that come off. And basically what happens is, let me back out here. This collar right here goes forward until the collar touches the case housing of the trimmer. And when this collar touches that housing, it stops and it can't go in anymore. And that's how this trimmer works. It actually is a beautiful trimmer. You know, some of the other trimmers on the market, you have to buy case holders and all kinds of things. This is an excellent option though. Okay, so let's go ahead and check the length of some of these cases that we just trimmed. 1.27, that one's good. Remember, the target was 1.275. Looks good. So we have good case length. Now we're ready to go to the next step, which is going to be expanding the case mouths. Okay, right now I'm in the process of trimming these 50 rounds, and I thought of something that I didn't want to miss, I didn't want to forget. And first thing is, I'm just trimming all these in one motion, and then I'll deburr them and chamfer them in a second motion. But what I'm trying to get, what I didn't want to forget is, if you know, later on in the reloading process, we're going to be seating bullets, obviously, and then we're going to be establishing a roll crimp to hold that bullet in place. Now, if you didn't have uniform case lengths, in other words, if you don't trim your brass, your roll crimps might vary round to round. So if you want uniform crimp on your bullet, make sure you trim your brass. I just thought I'd tell you that. I didn't want to leave that out. Okay, now, at this point, if you had, I had to step behind the camera there for a second. If you had
this brass that had already been fired, right now would be a good time to take a flathead screwdriver and knock all the carbon out of the primer pockets. But in our case, we don't have to worry about that. Another thing that people might say is to go inside the case from this angle and trim or deburr the flash holes. Now the reality is, and this is just my opinion, but the reality is that there's not enough accuracy in these pistol cartridges to warrant deburring the flash holes. Now you can if you'd like. It's not going to hurt anything, but you're basically, because when they, and if you don't understand what I'm talking about, is when they manufacture the brass, they have a punch that goes from the bottom and it punches through, and that's what creates the flash hole. Well, what happens is on the inside of the brass, there's all these burrs from that punch going through. So deburring the flash hole is just knocking down those burrs to a nice uniform flat hole. Again, though, on pistol cartridges, it's my opinion that it's not necessary, so I don't do it. On rifle cartridges, yeah, you might want to think about that. Okay, now that my brass is all resized, I want to put a bullet in, okay? But I can't do it, obviously, because there's no primer and no powder, but you can't get a bullet into the case because these are straight wall cases. So on pistol cartridges, the next step of the operation is to what they call bell the case mouth or expand the case mouth. And what that process is when you take the walls of the cases, you're basically flaring them out a little bit like so, so that the bullet can come into the case. Okay? And so that's the next step of the operation, is what we refer to as belling the case mouths. Okay, so I have my case mouth expansion die in my hand. I'm going to set it aside for a second. And what I need to do is I need to take out the first die. I need to take out the decapping and resizing die because I'm done with that operation. I'm going to loosen the die lock ring and I'm going to unthread the die. Take it all the way out. From here, I'm going to get the belling adjustment die or the case mouth expansion die that I talked about a second ago. And you notice I have all my settings loose. I have everything backed off all the way out. What I want to do is I want to raise the ram again and thread the die down again until the die body touches the shell holder. Once the die body touches the shell holder, I'm going to back the die out about one turn, hold the die body, and lock the die lock ring. This die is now locked into my press. From here, I'm going to take the bullet that I want to compare the cases to, set it close to the press, and I'm going to take my first case, insert it into the shell holder, and slowly raise the ram. Now you'll feel it touch against the belling insert. So you just want to slightly raise the ram all the way up, nice and slow, take the case out, and compare the case mouth and see if it'll accept a bullet yet. And if it doesn't, make a small adjustment on the case mouth expansion plug clockwise. And what I mean by small is like 1/8 of a turn increments, very small. Raise the ram and check the cartridge again and see if it fits. Okay, still not enough, so I'm going to make another adjustment up here, about 1/8 of a turn, raise the ram, check the cartridge again, and see, I want the bullet to barely fit into the case. Okay, I'm going to zoom in a little bit and get you a little better view.
So now I'm going to make a slight adjustment, raise the ram. Now let's check it out and see what we got. Now each time I'm making small clockwise increments on my bullet seating, or excuse me, my case mouth expansion plug. You want to make sure that you do not prime your cases prior to this step. If your cases are already primed, what could happen when you go to expand the case mouths is you could put air pressure into the case through that plug, and the result could be that you might pop out a primer a little bit. You don't want to do that, obviously. So I'm going to make a small adjustment, raise the ram, and again, let's take a look and see what we have now. The closer you get to the desired case mouth expansion, the smaller your increments need to be on the adjustment of your case mouth expansion plug. Very small increments. This step you got to be very careful with, very patient with, because you're doing the first one. And I don't like doing more than one. I like doing one and then moving forward to the, once I get my dial locked down, then I like to do them all. So I'm always very patient when I do the first one. If you make too large of an increment on your case mouth expansion plug, what could happen is you could give the case way too much expansion, and then when you seat the bullet and crimp the bullet, you'll be working that brass, basically stretching it out, stretching it back, and the result of all that stretching and unnecessary movement of the brass would shorten the lifespan of the brass. So each time that I raise the ram, if I feel like I need more case mouth expansion, I just go in about an eighth of a turn. Now we're getting very close. Now I'm turning it in about 16th of a turn increments, because I'm very close to the desired case mouth expansion. You don't want too much. You just barely want the bullet to sit in there. We're getting real close. You don't have to do this step with rifle cartridges for the most part. See how that fits in there nice and clean? So this is what you want. Here's your case. Let me back this camera out and get a better view. You want your bullet to just barely fit in there. You don't want too much case mouth expansion. You just barely want it to fit. Okay, so once you have the case mouth expansion set to where you want it, you'll put the case into the ram. I'm going to give it just a tad bit more. Excuse me, into the shell holder. I gave it about another 16th of a turn. I'm going to raise the ram up, and the reason I did that is because I locked the case mouth expansion plug. And the reason I locked that plug is because I want to lock that setting down. So now, holding the ram up, I'm going to tighten the case mouth expansion plug lock nut. Once I get to here, I'm going to take my crescent wrench and give it a slight tight. You know, I'm tightening it and double check. Now, this piece of brass is good to go. So I'm going to set this one aside and try another one. Now, this piece has not been expanded yet. See, you can see right here that the bullet won't fit in there. It won't accept the bullet. Raise the ram. Check it out, and it fits in there perfectly. And that's exactly what we want. Nice, clean case mouth expansion. Nothing crazy. So from here, I've got the die set. Everything's locked down. Now we can get after it. And again, like I mentioned earlier, make sure you don't prime your cases prior to this step. Looks good. Let's keep going. One thing that I want to mention about these 45 Long Colt cases is that they don't have a big lip on the bottom.
the lip is small on the bottom. They're not like a 44 mag or a 357 mag where they have a large lip. They have a small lip. So if you get something caught in a die and you try to lower the ram, there's a good chance that you could break off the lip of these cases. So be careful how much downward pressure you put on the ram of your press, pulling the case downward out of the die. So right now I'm just case mouth expanding. Okay, we're almost ready to prime the cases, but now we're going to just run a quick brush through the case mouths. Nothing too significant, but we'll run a brush through all these cases just to make sure they're nice and clean. We've already decapped, we've already resized, we've already trimmed, chamfered, deburred. We've just belled the case mouths. And now we're getting ready to prime, so just running this brush up in the mouth of the case. Okay, so now we're ready to prime the cases. So if you look at my note, you can see right here that it says Winchester Large Pistol Primers. And that's what I have in my hand, Winchester Large Pistol Primers. So I'm going to show you two methods that I like to use to prime the cases. The first method is using the Lee Auto Prime tool. This is a great tool. So basically what you do is you open the cover. Now these covers, they come in two sizes. This, I don't know if you can see this. There's an L right here in the center in the back, or there's an S. This one happens to be an L. So this one's used for large primers. Now, let me talk about this tool real quick. If you push this handle up, the handle will come off. And from here, you can take the primer tray off, like so, and you're left with the primer body and a shell holder. Now, you're probably sitting there wondering about shell holders. Yeah, this is a shell holder, but it's different than the shell holder that's in the press. Okay, this is the kind of shell holder that we had in the press. See the little notch on the bottom? This one's an RCBS number 20, and this is a Lee number 11. They both do the same job, obviously. They both hold the shell, obviously. I mean, you see that? They hold the shell for you. But the main difference is this is the type that pushes into the ram of the press. And these type are obviously for the Lee Auto Prime tool. So you can buy them individual or you can buy them in a set like this. I prefer to buy them by the set. A lot of times if you're into Lee products, which I love Lee products by the way, if you're into Lee products, and you buy like an anniversary set or a reloading kit, a lot of times they come with these shell holders if they come with the priming tool. Now inside you have a chart, and let me get to where I can see a little better, but this chart has a list of all the calibers that these shell holders are fit, and in our case we're looking for 45 Colt. So it says we can use a number 11 or a number 14. So in my hand here, I have, what is that? A number 11. So this is going to be the corresponding one for 45 Colt. So basically, it's the reverse of how I took it apart. We're going to take the shell holder, insert it into the body. We're going to take the large tray, put it in here, let it fit. Then we take this piece, this handle. Now make sure that you don't lose these two pieces, that they don't separate. There's a notch here that this fits in. Okay, it fits in this notch and it won't fall out unless it slides out. So I like to hold my fingers on either side of it and insert the round part here. Then I give it a mild push with my thumb forward, and then this little mouth here that you can see will bite this column here. Then we're all installed, we're ready to go. So from here, you take your primers, like so, put the thing on top, flip it over, now you have primers in there. Now sometimes, the primers, we naturally, they oriented correctly for us, but sometimes you'll have primers flipped over in the wrong orientation, you know, so they'll have the anvils down. Now, you see these little rings, those little rings? What those rings are is so that when I shake this tool, now watch these two that are oriented incorrectly. When I shake this tool, they bounce up and down off of those rings, and it orients the primers into the right side up. So the anvil is up. Now, before I seat any primer on any bullet, there's one thing I want to make sure to check, and that's that every single primer has a anvil. And that's the little three-part thing that looks like the wheel of a Hot Wheel. If it does not have an anvil, there's a good chance that that primer will not detonate and you'll have a dud round. So just take a quick second to look. Make sure that they all have anvils. From here, I'm going to put the lid on, and it'll lock into place. Now, I just kind of lower them down, and you'll see that there's a primer in there ready to come up. So I take my case, insert it into the shell holder, and make sure that the mouth of the case is pointed in a safe direction and that I have my glasses on still. And I'm just going to push with my thumb. I like to use both thumbs to get a little bit of pressure, and that will seat a primer. Okay, now once you seat the primer, you want to make sure that the primer is seated flush or just a little bit below flush. You don't want any of those slam fires. I like to get another loading block here and just put the primed cases in the loading block as I go. So again, one, this is a fairly quick process. It doesn't take a lot. It's very easy to do. Nothing crazy. Whoops. I put it in backwards. I'm looking at the camera, making sure I'm getting a good shot, and I didn't look at the brass. So you don't want to push too hard. You do want them to seat well. And that's basically all there is to the Lee Auto Prime tool. So that's one method to prime in your cases. Just like so. Okay, just a second ago I showed you how to prime with an auto prime tool, and I talked about the primers, and I was talking about making sure that you inspect them to make sure they have an anvil in it. Now what I've done is I've taken a primer and I've basically taken it apart into two pieces. You can see to the right, that's the anvil, and to the left, that's the cup. So if you do not have, you know, this is the cup, this is where the priming compound goes inside. This happens to be a spent primer, by the way, you can see by the dent on the back. But inside, you see, of the cup, that's where they put the priming compound. And the anvil sits inside the cup, like so. Just like that. Now what happens is when the firing pin hits the cup of the primer, it hits the priming compound and it pushes it up into the anvil. And more specifically, this portion of the anvil, let me get my pointer. It pushes it right into the center of the anvil, right there. I hope you can see that. This is kind of hard to show. It hits that portion right there, and that's where the ignition happens. So now, let me talk about another method of priming, and that's using the press. I like to raise the ram and rotate this priming arm into position. Now, there's two different cups that you can get on your priming arm. There's a large and a small.
So basically what you do is you put your primer in the cup, make sure it has an anvil, raise the ram slightly, put the case in, and I like to use my fingers as I push the rod, you know, push the handle, and what this will do is this will prime the case for you, nice and clean. This works good if you don't have a lot of hand strength or if you don't have a lot of dexterity in your hands. Maybe you're an older individual. This works very well. So it's just like so. And you get a good feel for the primer. And again, you want to make sure it's flush or just below flush. So it's like so. Raise the ram slightly. Insert the case and push slowly. That's how you prime the cases on the press. I'll show you another angle. Okay, so here we come. I'm putting the primer into the cup. Raise the ram a little bit. Insert the case into the shell holder and slowly push forward. Looking at the primer, checking to see how it's seated. And it looks good. Let's do that again. Put the primer into the cup. Make sure it has an anvil. Put a piece of brass in. And push forward. Nice, smooth operation. You see me running my finger along it. And the reason I do that is because I'm feeling to see how well seated the primer is. This does not take a lot of pressure. It's a very easy process. Nothing hard about it at all. Okay, right here I have my 50 cases that are primed. And now it's time to powder the cases. So I'm going to make another note. I'm going to look at my powder charge, and I'm using Alliant Unique powder, anywhere between 7.4 and 9.3, but my target weight is right in the middle, about 8.4, 8.5, something like that. So I'm going to share with you a couple of techniques that I like to use to powder my bullets. Now, first thing is the balance scale. I'm going to zoom in, and you can see right now that my scale is straight on zero. Okay, so my scale is zeroed. Let me move my tripod over just a second. So my scale is zeroed. You can also tell that I have my little weight. This happens to be the RCBS 502 scale. And you can see that my little weight over here is on zero, and that this little weight is also on zero. Okay, so both of my weights are on zero. Now, the target weight that I'm looking for is 8.4. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with this big weight. Now, every one of those small lines represents a 5. So you have, for example, 5 all the way to here, which would be 25, and then this big line would be 50. So I'm gonna go up one small line, up to 5, right there. You can see I'm on 5. Now you can also see that the scale has kind of fallen down because I don't have 5 grains of powder in it. But I want 8.5, so my next move is to move this small weight to about 3.4 or 3.5. That'll give me 8.4 grains of powder. Okay, so I'm going to go 3.4. So there's 3. If I go to this big line right here where my finger is, that would be 3.5. I want to go just one below it. 3.4. Now let me go back to 5. So that's my target weight of 8.4 grains of powder. See that? And again, this is the RCBS 502 scale. So now, at this point, what I can do is I can take my small scoop right here, and I have my powder trickler full of powder, and I'm just going to take small scoops. I hope you can see this. I'm like dancing around the tripod trying to not get in the way here. This is, move my trickler a little bit. I'm going to take this little bit of powder and I'm going to put it in the bowl. Kind of push the scale and try to get it moving a little bit. Let's take a look and see where we're at. Not enough powder. There. Now we're starting to move. Now, if you can see on the end over here, I'll zoom in a little bit and hopefully you can see that we're just a little bit short of our target weight. We're just a little bit short of the 8.5. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to trickle up. I'm turning my trickler, and what that's doing is it's dropping powder one grain at a time. Or should I say one granule at a time. And what happens as a result is my scale will start to balance to that weight. Now, from here, it looks like I'm on. Let's take a look. Looks like I'm right on 8.4. See that? So let's double check. We're on 5, 6, 7, 8.4. And the scale zeroed at that weight. So we are right at 8.4 grains. At this point, what I like to do is I like to take my case, take my powder funnel, remove the charge from the scale, and put it into the case. So now we have a charged case with 8.4 grains of powder. Now let me get a flashlight. I don't know if you could see in there. And I'm going to set that aside. Now if you had a loading block, which I used to, but I got rid of it. I gave it to a friend of mine. He got set up on reloading, and I gave him my loading block, so I don't have it anymore. So I'm just setting them aside on my bench over there. So I put the bowl back in and we do the same process. Right until we zero. I always keep the powder that I'm using handy on my bench, so I never get confused as far as what kind of powder I'm using. So again, looks like we have another zeroed case at 8.4. Everything looks good. So now I'm going to take another empty case, take that charge, and again, I'm going to insert it into the case here. Put the bowl back on the scale. Set the case aside. Let's do it again. I think the art of using a balanced scale like this is kind of a lost art. This is the way I was taught to reload, was using a balanced scale. But nowadays they have so much automatic stuff and so much digital stuff, I think it kind of takes the art away, and I think it kind of, you know, makes people more demanding on technology instead of, you know, common sense. Now that one's just a little hot, so that one's probably 8.5 or something like that. But that's okay, because like I said earlier, it's well within our spectrum of what we're wanting to load. So I'll take the case, take my funnel, Pardon me for stepping in front of the scale. Take the charge and put it right there. Now, a little trick that I want to mention is, as far as your funnels are concerned, you know, you notice that the powder went right into the case very easily. If you ever get powder that's not going directly into the case easily, or should I say powder sticking to the case, if you can find a dryer sheet out of your dryer, that will help eliminate that static electricity, and it'll help your powder from sticking so much. Now look at that one. That one's real hot. We need to take some powder out. Got a little crazy on that one. Looks like we're about 8.3 there, maybe. Add a couple granules. Again, we're going to take our funnel. Take the load of powder. So dryer lint works really well. Another thing that you could do is, if you had a powder charge in your funnel here, or excuse me, in your pan, you could take the pan right into the case and dump the powder in, just like so. I'm going to go ahead and do that. Whoops. So we're starting to register. Got hot there. Now, these scales are what they refer to as magnetically dampened scales, and what that means is there's magnets up here in the mouth or throat area, and as that bar goes up and down and it starts to wobble, those magnets help settle it down so it's not as violent of an operation. It's a very smooth movement. You might be sitting there thinking, wow, man, that's a lot of work doing it that way. I'm only doing it this way for the video. Normally, I don't use this method too much. I used to. Rifle cartridges, you know, I would do it this way a lot. So again, I take the funnel, put it in the case. I have a good charged case. Or excuse me, a good... Let's do it without the funnel. That's what I was going to show. I just put the funnel in. And pour it nice and slow. There it is. So that's one method of charging your cases. Okay, the next method I'm going to share with you is essentially the same technique, except we're going to be using the Frankfurt Arsenal digital scale. This is a very inexpensive digital scale. It works great though. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to take whatever kind of bowl, I'm going to take it and set it on the scale, get my trickler in place, get all my stuff in place, and when I turn the scale on, now I'm going to go ahead and zoom in a little bit so you can see these numbers. When I turn the scale on, what will happen is the scale will zero to the bowl that's sitting on it. So now from here, this is a little bit easier than the balance scale. As I add, you know, the numbers change. Now I can trickle up and I can get right to my 8.4. You know, I can get right to the desired weight. You might be sitting there thinking, man, this is pretty boring. We went over just a hair. We went to 8.5, but that's okay because we're well within our spectrum. So I'm going to take that powder, just like I did on the balance scale. And I'm going to put it in here. See, there's a little bit of static. That's what I was talking about. You could get a dryer sheet and it'll knock that static out and your powder won't stick as much. Now you want to make sure that when you're between powder charges that your scale zeroes. Now, another method that I like to use is something like this. This is a small scoop that I made out of a 45 ACP case. And what I've done is I've cut it down to where it throws approximately 8.4, 8.5. So I fill it up about that full. And I just dump it in there. Look at that, 8.3. So it's pretty close. You can trickle up. If you're not worried about, you know, real consistent ammo, that would be a good way of doing it. I'm banging on it because I'm trying to get the powder to fall. So again, we'll take that little scoop. Whoops, dumped a little powder. Let me clear that real quick. Make sure I'm zeroed. I've had my scoop here full. 8.0. I had a light scoop apparently. There it is, 8.5. Okay, so now I want to show another technique that's pretty neat. You can take an empty case, obviously it's a primed case. We know that that charge is 8.5. I lifted it and remeasured it. So we're going to set that charge aside. We know that that's 8.5. Turn the scale off, move the trickler back. Now, when I put the brass on the scale, I can turn the scale on, and what will happen is the scale will zero to that piece of brass. Now, I can remove that piece of brass and put this 8.5 charge that I had set aside into my case, and it's back to the scale, 8.5. So you can measure it that way. Now, you want to be careful doing it this way, though, because if you grab another piece of brass, we don't know if this new piece of brass weighs the same as the old piece of brass. So in our case, we lucked out there. It did zero. But sometimes you'll see a variance in the weights of the brass, you know, especially if you're using different manufacturers. Look at that one. It's lighter by 0.5. So this one, you know, you would have to turn the scale off and recalibrate to that piece of brass. Now when you finish with that and you put these other ones on, they're probably going to show possibly that they might be a little heavier. See that? Plus 5. 0.5, I mean. So you got to be careful using this technique. So I like going to the old method of zeroing my scale to the bowl. This is the case I'm going to charge. Another thing I want to mention when it comes to scale and powder and all that is be careful when you're using digital scales or any scale for that matter if there's wind or air flow in the room. Now I'm going to zoom in a little bit so you can see what I'm talking about. All I'm going to do right now is blow on the scale and watch what happens to the numbers. And I'm not even blowing that hard. So you can see how precise these scales are and how touchy they are. So be careful with that. You know, some guys they get in a hot room or something and they wanna use, you know, a fan or something to make it cooler in there. Be careful doing that. So I'm just scooping it. This one's probably gonna be a little bit hot. 8.8. Let's remove a little bit. 8.6, let's go a little bit lighter. There's 8.5 right there. If you want your scale to re-register, just lift the tip and set it back down and it'll re-measure. Let's go up. There it is right there. Now this is the case that we had earlier. We're going to charge. And that case is now charged. Now what you see here is a powder measure that measures by volume. Now it doesn't measure by weight, it measures by volume. And this one happens to be the Hornady Lock and Load powder measure. Works great. It's a powder dispenser. So basically what you do, and now I have a scale down here on the table that you can't see, but I'm going to zero my bowl to this scale, and I'm going to lift my bowl up, and I'm going to throw a charge. Okay, now once I have the charge, I'm going to take it down and measure it. Right now it says 8.6. So I have a good charge here. Another thing that you could do is you could take a piece of brass that you're going to charge, just like I did earlier. You could zero it to your scale. There, it's zeroed. Hold it underneath, throw a charge into it, and measure that brass, 8.6. So that's another technique that you could use using the powder measure. Okay, this one happens to be, like I said, made by Hornady. Now, if you want to adjust the amount of powder that you're throwing, if you turn this knob here clockwise this way, it's going to reduce the amount of powder that it throws. If you turn it counterclockwise, it's going to increase the amount of powder that you throw. And this device works really good for measuring powder. Now, you see this round silver cylinder looking thing? That's the metering insert, and that's the rotor. This is actually the metering insert, and this round part's the rotor. Now, I have the standard metering insert and standard rotor. Now, what you could do, though, is you could buy the pistol rotor and pistol metering insert. It comes as a kit. And what that does is that makes it throw a much more consistent charge, specifically for pistol cases. So again, you take your brass, come underneath, and you're charged. And when I use this, it's much faster, and I like to check about every fifth or sixth one when I use the powder measure. Works great. That was one of the best tools that I could have bought. Now, with that being said, there's another powder measure on the market that's made by Lee. This one's a Hornady. It's kind of pricey. But there's one made by Lee. They call it the perfect powder measure, and it's very inexpensive. I think it's only like $20. And that thing works great. It really does. I'll show you what that looks like here shortly. So this is the Lee perfect powder measure. You can adjust your powder charges by this screw. You open the top, you put your powder in, and you basically mount this to something, and it throws a very accurate charge. Now, when you buy this, it feels very cheap and it feels very inexpensive, but the honest to God truth is this thing throws a very consistent charge. Very good for the money. Another thing that I like about it is if you look through here, you can see air through there. Now, if I turn the cylinder, you see how it stops it and opens it and close it? That's kind of neat, because when you get done charging all your cases, you can close this and lift it off, and your powder's in here, and then you just dump your powder back in your bowl, and then all you have to clear is this chamber. Okay, and it's not hard at all. So if you're on a budget, or even if you're not on a budget but you want a good inexpensive one, I would highly recommend looking at the Lee perfect powder measure. It's a good tool. So again, here's another look at the operation. I've got my scale. I turn my scale on. This is the case that I want to charge. I'm going to set that case down. I'm zeroed. I come through a charge. I put it on the scale, 8.6. Here's my funnel. Here's my powder. There we go. Now we're ready to rock and roll again. And what else is nice about these is if you're going to be loading your loads within a spectrum like we are,
you can load them right around 8.4, 8.5, and it won't get outside of those parameters unless something goes haywire. I've never seen one do that because they throw by volume. So that's a good option for measuring your powder. I really like this option. Highly recommend it. Okay, right now, what I like to do is I like to go down and I like to look in each case and I like to verify the powder charges. I'm looking down in each one and I'm looking for any discrepancies, anything that looks out of order. Everything looks okay, right? Let's take a closer look. I'm looking at the powder level in relation to the cases. First row looks good. Second row looks good. Third row looks good. Aha. You see that? I overloaded one on purpose so you could see it. Just like I did in the 223 video. Everything looking good so far, right? Aha. So, these bottom two, this one that I'm looking at right in the center of the screen, this one has a double charge in it, and the next one has about half of a charge. See that? So you can see that the powder levels in relation to the ones next to them. That's what I'm looking at. You can clearly see that those two on the end are high and excessively low. So I thought I would do that for a learning tool. So I'm going to take these out, empty them, and I'll throw a new charge for them. Let me set this camera down. Okay, now I'm back and I just charged these two cases again. Let's take a look again. Now, like I mentioned earlier, normally I use a loading block, but I gave it to a friend of mine. So now let's look at the levels. Notice the levels now are consistent with the cases around them, and that's really what we're looking for. We're looking for powder level in relation to the case next to it. Everything looks good, right? So I threw that in there as a learning tool. I hope you found it useful. So always double check your powder on your cases before you even think to seat a bullet. Okay, now we've got all our cases charged. We're getting ready to seat bullets. In my hand, I have the bullet seating / crimp die, but I'm not going to deal with that yet. What I'm going to do, since I move these cases, is I'm going to take my flashlight and I'm just going to quickly verify that I didn't spill any powder or anything like that. I want to make sure that these charges are still lined up the way they were just a second ago when I checked them. Now, normally I would be using a loading block to move all my stuff around. And I mentioned that earlier. I don't have one though right now because I gave it to a friend of mine. So let's go back to the bullet seating die / crimp die. If you notice in this kit, the die comes with two bullet seating stems. One of them has a round nose and one of them has a flat point on it. So what you want to do is you want to take the bullet that you're going to be loading and you want to compare it to the seating stems and find the seating stem that's appropriate to your bullet. So if you had a round nose bullet, obviously you'd want to use the round bullet seating stem, but in our case we're going to use the flat bullet seating stem. Now if you don't have the round one, or if you don't have the flat one, chances are good that you could probably use one or the other. You know, in other words, if I had the round one installed here in the die, I could probably use that to install these bullets. It's no problem. But you just want to try to get it as close as possible. So now it's time to insert the die into the press. So the first thing I want to do is take a loaded case, and I mean loaded by powder, it's full of powder, and I want to raise the ram all the way up. From here I want to thread the die down until the die body touches the case mouth. Once I feel the die body, there it goes, you can feel it touching the case mouth, and I'm raised the ram all the way up, obviously. Once it touches the case mouth, I want to back the die out approximately one turn and lock the die lock ring. What this will do is this will take away the crimping feature of the die at this point in time. So now I lower the ram and I take my bullet. I put my bullet into the press. I'm going to start to raise the ram. From here, the ram's all the way up and I don't feel any tension at all. So I'm going to tighten the bullet seating stem until I feel it touch the tip of the bullet. Then I'm going to lower the ram slightly and give this bullet seating stem a turn or two and raise the ram. From here, this will start to seat the bullet. Now I'm going to change camera angles and I'll be right back. Okay, when it comes to seating the very first bullet, you want to be extremely patient. Okay, so I know obviously that bullet depth is not what I want, so I'm going to turn the bullet seating stem a couple of turns and I'm going to raise the ram and seat the bullet a little more. From here, I want to look at my paper here, and more specifically, I'm looking at my overall length. 1.575 is the recommended overall length, but not to exceed 1.60. So as long as I'm within that spectrum of overall length, it's going to be okay. Now, if I was dealing with a semi-automatic pistol, it would make a little bit more... How can I say that? It would be a little more important to be right on the money, but since I'm shooting them out of a revolver, it's not really going to be that significant. Okay, so the ideal overall length that I'm looking for is 1.575. So I'm going to turn on my calipers here, and I'm looking for 1.575. So I'm at 1.674. I'm over, so I'm going to come back to the press, slowly increase the amount of bullet seating depth. I went about a half a turn there, seat the bullet. Now let's take another measurement. We're looking for 1.575, 1.61, so we're getting closer. I'm going to go about an eighth of a turn, quarter of a turn, something like that, seat the bullet, and let's come measure again. Now, as always, the closer you get to your desired seating depth, the smaller your increments need to be. Now, this is 1.594, so technically, if I wanted to, I could call that good right there, because it's under the 1.60, but I'm actually aiming for 1.575, so I'm going to put it back in the press. Now, the closer you get, the smaller increments you need to make. Raise the ram. I might have already said that, but never hurts to say it again, I guess. So I'm here, I'm looking for 1.575, 1.584, so we're getting closer. Now let's make a small adjustment. I went about an eighth of a turn. Raise the ram, seat a little more. Let's check our bullet seating depth. 1.577.
So that's good. Let's go just a tiny, tiny bit more. About a 16th of a turn. Raise the ram. Seat just a tiny bit more. We're looking for 1.575. 1.573. So that's good. We're just barely under. Okay, now, so when it comes to seating bullets, the very first bullet that you do is the most important. That's the one that you have to have the most patience with. It's kind of like cutting a piece of wood. If you cut it too short, it's just flat too short. But if you cut it too long, you can always cut it again. And that's how I look at it when it comes to seating bullets. If I seat the bullet and it's too long, that's okay. I can always seat a little bit more. So now, what my plan is to establish a crimp, a roll crimp, to hold the bullet in place. Now normally, there's enough neck tension on the case mouth to hold this bullet in place. See how far, how deep it's embedded in there? But we have to roll this crimp because remember we expanded the case mouth? Now we have to take that case mouth expansion out. So, the first thing I want to do is I want to take out my bullet seating stem. Not all the way out, but I want to basically unadjust it. You know, and you're probably thinking that's kind of counterintuitive. You just spent all that work establishing your overall length. Well, I'll explain that here in a second. So, I'm loosening the die lock ring, and everything is loose on the die. Now, I'm going to insert the case into the press. And I'm going to slowly raise the ram. Now, I'm going to tighten down the die body until I feel it touch the case. From here, I'm going to lower the ram slightly, and in 1/8 of a turn increments, I'm going to turn the die body clockwise and lower and then raise the ram. And what I'm looking for is a nice roll crimp on the case. I don't see nothing yet. Let me go another little bit. Still nothing. 1/8 of a turn increments. Don't get too excited when you adjust this die body for this crimp feature. Because if you do, if you go too far, what can happen is you could crimp the whole case. You could crinkle the whole case, smash it, bend it. And you don't want to do that. So we're taking our time, being very patient, small increments, and we're starting to show a little bit of roll on the crimp here. And I'm just looking right in this area. Small increments, 1/8 or less. We're getting very close, a little bit more. And I mentioned earlier when we were trimming the brass that if you didn't trim your brass and you get to this point in the process, you might wish that you had trimmed your brass, because if you don't, you're going to have uneven crimps on your bullets. Some of them are going to crimp, some of them aren't, because the brass, the case length, trim lengths are different on the brass. So I'm going a small bit more. And once you find that you've got the crimp that you want, which that looks really good, then what you'll do is you'll put the bullet in the shell holder, raise the ram, and lock the die lock ring. When you lock the die lock ring, what you're doing essentially is you're locking the crimp adjustment of the die body. Okay, now from here we need to go back to our bullet seating depth. So what we're going to do is we're going to lower the bullet seating stem down until we feel it touch the case, or should I say the bullet. From here we're going to lock the lock ring. Now remember we were 1.573 or something, we were just a little bit under. So I'm going to reduce it back counterclockwise approximately 1/16 of a turn. Now, that's our target bullet. Now let's take another charged case put it into the press, get our bullet, and now the die should do two things. It should do the bullet seating depth, and it should crimp the bullet all in one motion. And that looks pretty good. Now let's take a measurement and see how it looks. Remember, 1.575 is what we're hoping for. 1.577, 1.576. So that looks good. That's pretty darn close. If you wanted to adjust it down, get it closer to that 1.575, it's not necessary in our case, but I'll show you anyway. You can loosen the die, the bullet seating stem, and just tighten the bullet seating stem just a tiny, tiny bit. Put the bullet back in the ram and raise it up, and that might get you what you're looking for. That's perfect. So now we have two bullets that are finished. Now we can take another case that's charged, obviously. Put it in the ram, in the shell holder. You don't know why I keep saying ram. Put it in the shell holder, insert a bullet, raise the ram. We're going to crimp, seat, all that stuff. Now let's take a measurement. We should be right at 1.575. Yep, 1.5755. So we're right on it. So that's how we're going to establish our bullet. And from there, we want to go ahead and continue the process of seating the bullets. Don't get in a hurry on how fast you bring the ram up into the die and things like that. Take your time. There's no rush. It's not a race. And as the bullet comes out of the die, you want to kind of inspect it. Make sure the primer is seated well. Look at the roll crimp. Look at the bullet, all those things. Reloading it's something that takes a lot of patience. It takes a lot of attention to detail to get good bullets. Here's another view. Looks good. Now you never want to seat a bullet onto a case that's not charged. I've seen people drop cases or knock them over and spill half the powder out, and they'd seat a bullet on that. So make sure that you don't do that. Make sure that on every single bullet that you reload, always, that you check that powder before you even seat a bullet. Because you don't want to get out to the range and find out that, oh wow, I must have not put powder in that one or something, You don't want that to happen to you. You don't want to be that guy on the shooting range. So I'm looking down always, making sure that they're charged. Looks good. Here's a view for you guys that might want to see the linkage work on this press.
So while I'm finishing up these last few bullets, I want to talk to you about a couple things. And one of them is the trim of the brass, and the other is the roll crimp onto the bullet. Now, those two parts, I guess you could say, are very important, because if you have consistency on those two components, those two parts of the process, you're going to get a very consistent release of the bullet. You're going to get a very consistent burn rate of your powder, and you're probably going to get a very consistent accuracy. So trim is important, and so is the crimp. They go hand in hand. So the last thing that I like to do is I like to inspect the bullets, and I'm loading them from one block to another, and I've got a small rag in my hand, and I'm basically removing any residue that's on the brass. I'm feeling with my fingers, I'm looking visually at the roll crimp, I'm looking at the primers to make sure the primers are seated well, that they're not bulging out or anything like that. And if they pass the inspection, I put them in the next loading block, and if they don't, I set them aside and I might pull the bullets out of them and save the contents. Another thing I want to mention is the brown coating that you see on the bullet. Now, I talked about that earlier, that's liquid Alox. Don't rub that off with the rag. If you do, the bullets will look a lot prettier. You know, this one here, they look really nice, but you're rubbing off the bullet lubricant. So again, I want to say thank you for watching. Woo, that guy fell. Thank you for watching. I appreciate the support. Feel free to comment, subscribe, like, thumbs up, all that stuff. And as always, have a beautiful day, everybody. We'll see you on the next one. Bye-bye now.